Since 1981, when the Georgia Southern program was reborn, the Eagles have ridden the yellow school bus on game days. Six national titles and now a 2014 Sun Belt crown hasn't changed that. Today, the blue and white faces longtime rival, the Citadel. And today also marks the return of Georgia Southern All-Conference quarterback Kevin Ellison. It all starts now on ESPN.
Welcome to Paulson Stadium in Statesboro, Georgia, where this evening longtime rivals the Citadel and Georgia Southern meet for the 24th time. And good evening, I'm Matt Stewart, joined by former Auburn Tigers, All-American, first-round draft pick, and 15-year NFL veteran Wayne Gandy. And Wayne, the Citadel and Georgia Southern, very familiar with each other. They played against each other for 20 years in the SoCon. Georgia Southern has moved up to FBS and the Sun Belt. How does that change the dynamic of this rivalry?
Actually, it makes Citadel more hungry to beat them. They kind of left them saying, hey, we'll put you behind us, but the Citadel is here to try to rectify that. The rivalry continues.
The Citadel Bulldogs are a true triple option team. They bring back 10 starters on offense from last year's team. The one starter they have to replace is the most important guy on the offensive side, and that's their quarterback, Dominique Allen, who makes his third career start tonight.
Dominique Allen, a versatile, double dual running back, quarterback that can get the job done. Not asked to throw a lot, but when he does, he's very effective. He's the trigger man for this offense, especially when you're running the triple option. Watch for him. So goes he, so goes this team.
And Allen averaging 176 yards of total offense, leading the Bulldogs to a 2-0 start. Meantime, Georgia Southern gets their starting quarterback back tonight. Kevin Ellison had missed the first two games with an academic suspension. But whoever the quarterback is, Matt Breida is the star of this offense.
Matt Breida, not just a top running back in the Sun Belt, but one of the top running backs in the country. He can score from 5, he can score from 10, and he has the ability and the speed to take it the distance from anywhere on the field. You should hear his name a lot. Not a lot of touches, but it's very big plays when he does.
And Breida averaging 8.8 yards per carry. And Kevin Ellison chomping at the bit to get the start here tonight. Rushed for over 1,000 yards, passed for over 1,000 yards last season. One of only four quarterbacks nationally to accomplish that feat. It's the Georgia Southern Eagles and the Citadel Bulldogs. Last three meetings between these two teams decided by less than a touchdown. Opening kick is coming up next. Back at Paulson Stadium in Statesboro, Georgia, on a toasty Saturday evening, the Citadel and Georgia Southern meeting for the first time since 2013. Mike Houston in his second season as the Bulldogs head coach, 7-7 after great success at Lenoir Rhyne, leading them to the Division II National Championship game in his final season there in 2013. And Willie Fritz in his second season as Georgia Southern's head coach. 10-4 his record in Statesboro. Overall, 186 victories in his 23 seasons as a head coach. He is 14th on the active win list. Just one win behind Arizona's Rich Rodriguez and three ahead of Ohio State's Urban Meyer. 24th all-time meeting between these two rivals that played each other every year until 2014, a year ago. Georgia Southern leads the series 18-5 and leads the series 12-1 here at Paulson Stadium. Quinlan Washington standing deep for the Bulldogs at the goal line, and Alex Hanks has teed it up and is ready to kick for Georgia Southern. Georgia Southern 1-1, coming off a 43-17 win against Western Michigan in this stadium last Saturday night, and we are underway as Washington
takes it 5 yards deep in the end zone, will take a knee, and the Bulldogs will open at their 25-yard line. The Citadel offense has scored 97 points in their first two games, second highest total in the SoCon, and the program's most through two games since 2007. The number one rushing team in FCS, averaging 438 yards on the ground. And here come the Bulldogs on offense, led by their quarterback, number 19, Dominique Allen, a 6'1", 214-pound sophomore out of Richmond Hill, Georgia High School. First carry of the ball game to Evan McField. And McField picks up 3 yards on the play. And Wayne, let's take a look at the impact players when the Citadel is on offense.
Looking at Vinny Miller, the senior A-back, really a leader on this offense, and linebacker Deshante Gallen on their defense. He's a playmaker, a little short, but a lot of talent in that small body.
And we have movement. It looked like Vinny Miller, the A-back, who we just talked about as an impact player for the Citadel, moved, and
he's
also
ready to go.
On the offensive line.
57, 5 yard penalty.
The penalty is going to be called on the left guard, Kyle Weaver. Citadel coming off a 28-10 Southern Conference victory over Western Carolina. The Catamounts picked to finish second in the SoCon. Mike Houston optimistic of that very good start in the league after they went 3-4 in the conference in his first season. So second down and 12 now from the 23. Right up the middle, a gain of 4 on the play, goes McField again. McField, a 6 foot, 221-pound redshirt freshman out of Goose Creek, South Carolina High School, right down there in the Lowcountry.
Look for a big day from Matt Dobson and Antonio Glover. Whenever you go against a running team, especially an option team, your safeties have to come up and make that tackle right where they hit them in the spot. No extra yards right there for the Citadel.
Third down and 8. And Allen goes to the air. Ball batted down, and it's intercepted. Intercepted at the line of scrimmage. Ross Alexander comes up with the interception as he batted the ball right up into the air, right out of the arms of Dominique Gallen, and a turnover in great field position for the Eagles.
Big, big play right there for the Eagles. The Citadel doesn't drop back to throw a lot. 8 to 10 times a game right there, just a bad mistake. Nice, nice defense by the Eagles blocking the ball. Mr. Ross, big smile on his face going to the sideline. Linebackers always enjoy getting interceptions any kind of way they can get them.
So first down and 10 for the Eagles at the Citadel 11-yard line. We'll see if they can cash in quickly on this early gift. Handoff goes to Breida. And Breida tries the left side and picks up maybe 2 yards on the play.
Big question today, will this Bulldog defense be able to handle Matt Breida and his running attack? Will they be able to string it out long enough that the help can come? Gang tackling will be important for this defense.
Second down and 8. Ball at the 9-yard line. Breida gets the handoff again, slips out of a tackle and down to the 5-yard line goes Matt Breida.
Nice strong run right there by Breida. He's known for his speed, not so much talk about his strength, but right there working for those extra yardage. Nice handoff by Ellis, and I'm quite sure he has the jitters. He wants to get going, but right now the OC knows, hey, let's get the ball to Breida, get you comfortable and back in the game.
So third down and 3 coming up from the 5. Ellison rolling to his right, now going to run it. And Ellison will be dropped at the 5-yard line. Didn't get there, tackled by the linebacker, James Riley. And it's going to be fourth down and a big stop for the Citadel after giving up the turnover at the 11-yard line.
When Ellison turns on the film tomorrow, he's gonna hit himself side the head. He had number 23, Derek Keaton, wide open in the flat in the end zone. Just first game back, jitters, just wants to get a play under his belt. Bad read there by our man Kevin Ellison.
Alex Hanks, a 22-yard attempt. It is on its way, and it is good. So Alex Hanks salvages 3 points following the interception by Ross Alexander, and Georgia Southern with the early lead in Statesboro. So a good start for the Georgia Southern Eagles, but also a good start for the Citadel, kind of a win-win. Georgia Southern gets the turnover, gets 3 points. Good news for the Citadel is they held them to just 3 points.
Anytime you have a turnover deep in your territory, if your defense can take the field and cause some kind of fumble or interception themselves or hold to 3 points, you can take your hat off to them.
Alex Hanks, who just hit his third field goal of the season a few moments ago, will now kick off again. And Washington drifts over 4 yards deep, going to bring it out this time. And Washington will make it back to the 20-yard line before being brought down by Darius Jones. And that's where the Citadel will go on offense for the second time. And, Wayne, we see if they can do something a little bit better this time around.
They got to the edge a little bit on that first drive. This time they're going to have to move the ball. They can't keep giving them short field. Kevin Ellison, once he gets a couple of plays on him, I expect him to explode on the scene today.
Georgia Southern, the number one scoring defense in the Sun Belt Conference a year ago, number three in total defense. I think that was one of the untold stories with this Georgia Southern team a year ago. So much focus on their offense going 8-0 in the conference, but their defense was just as good, if not better. So Allen on the keeper. He picks up 6 yards on the play up to the 25-yard line. Wayne, kind of explain the difficulty that the quarterback and the responsibility that the quarterback has to take on in this triple option offense.
Well, the first difficulty is 99, Jay Ellis and Derek Sepp. If you look out on the field, they're the two numbers, 99 and 90, that you can't miss. So this offensive line that is a little undersized is really going to have to control right there. If they can control them and keep them out the backfield.
On second down and 4, looks like McField picks up 5, and that'll be a first down for the Citadel.
Keeping these two D tackles under control, being undersized, will be a great plus here for Dominique Allen. He's going to need all the room and all the reads, and sometimes when people get pressure in a triple option, it disturbs the quarterback greatly.
So first and 10 for the Bulldogs from the Georgia Southern, or pardon me, their own 30-yard line. Pitch goes to Vinny Miller. Miller trying to turn the edge, and he does on the cutback, and a big 10-plus yard gain, over 15 yards, about 18 yards on the pickup for Vinny Miller right there, and a great cutback by the senior out of North Augusta, South Carolina.
Running hard, the leader of this offense. We spoke about earlier how Matt Dobson and Glover are going to have to come up and make those tackles. You have to be able to make those tackles when they're there. Right there, you can see the hard running of Vinny Miller. Making those extra yardage. Really stopped Cole for a loss.
First and 10 from the 47. Short gain of about 3 yards right there for Evan McField.
Keeping them honest, always have to keep. I know a lot of people look at the triple option and think, won't you just keep working the edge? But you have to keep those linebackers honest and make them pay attention to that B-back.
That's Cam Jackson, number 18, the A-back, one of the starting A-backs, two A-backs in this formation. He's also the backup quarterback, so in essence, the Citadel has two quarterbacks on the field always at the same time. McField on the run, and a strong run for Evan McField as he gets down to the 44-yard line and picks up close to 5 on the play.
And, Matt, as we talked to Coach this week, he talked about Mike Houston, talked about how he has to look for talent anywhere that can run the ball. Some of these guys in high school were former option quarterbacks. Right there is your point. All over the place you have former quarterbacks playing running back here in this Citadel system.
Third down and 1. Ball is fumbled and Allen gets on top of it. They lose a yard on the play. Going to bring up a fourth down and 2 on the Georgia Southern side of the 50. Do you go for it this early?
I think you came here to win. I think that you know you can get 2 yards. It's on your team. This is what you're built to do, to get 2-3 yards a clip. So there's no negative, really, when you think about it.
Big early call here by head coach Mike Houston and his OC Brent Thompson to go for it on 4th-and-2 from the Georgia Southern 45-yard line. Allen back to pass, throws for the first. Oh, it's dropped. That was a first down, and Alex Glover dropped a sure first down catch.
Something we saw during pregame against Air. Some of the throws and receptions were dropped against Air right there, playing right into the real game. Bad, bad play right there. They needed to keep that drive going. It was there on 4th-and-2. Surprised all of us that they even threw the ball.
Wayne, that was all on Glover right
yes,
there.
Yes, that's all on Glover.
He had that, and he tried to run before he had it or something to that effect, and the ball goes over on downs to Georgia Southern at their own 45-yard line.
The one thing you like to see in those situations, just catch the ball. Don't worry about getting extra. Go to the pylon, get the ball. Go to the sticks, get the ball, and fall down.
Ellison out here to Longoria. Ryan Longoria steps out of bounds at the 50. That's a 5-yard pickup on the first completion of the ball game for Kevin Ellison. Longoria with his first catch of the season, injured and missed most of last season. He's a junior out of Hacienda Heights, California.
I'm quite sure right there Kevin Ellison is finally I got it out the way. It's sounding, getting that first pass is always big, regardless of the down and distance.
Ellison, the junior out of Cornelia, Georgia, up in northeast Georgia, Habersham Central High School. Breida on the carry. Not much doing for Breida right there as he got stopped just beyond the line of scrimmage. Tevin Floyd, their middle linebacker, making that stop right there.
Playing this 4-3 defense, playing a great runner in Breida. They're going to have to gang tackle right there. They've run up the middle 3 or 4 times. Haven't had a lot of success as the Eagles.
Third down and 5. Georgia Southern 1-1 on the season. Opened with a big loss at West Virginia. Came back with a big win at Western Michigan. Or against Western Michigan here, I should say. Breida close to the first down. Got his body across the 45, which should be good for the first.
Spread them out. Flip it out to Breida. Let him use his speed to get the first down right there, edging it out. He's so dynamic, Matt. Sometimes you hold your breath because you think he's going to come out of there and go the distance. That's the kind of talent he is at running back.
Junior out of Brooksville, Florida, Nature Coast Tech. One carry as a freshman, came back, was all Sunbelt last year, first team as a sophomore. Ellison flushed out of the pocket, quarterback sack. Mark Thomas, the defensive end out of Brunswick, Georgia, picks up the quarterback sack and drops Ellison for a 5-yard loss back close to the 50.
Nice coverage. That was a coverage sack all the way. Nowhere to go with the ball right there was Ellison. A lot of pressure coming, and that's what they're going to need today. They're going to have to, when he does drop back and throw this ball, they're going to have to get some pressure. It's his first game back, so he's not comfortable. Try to keep him that way if you're the Citadel.
Second down and long now. Ellison to throw and threw it short. That's going to be an incompletion at the 42-yard line, intended target Ryan Longoria. So now third down and long.
These are the kind of plays that he has to work himself back into. Everybody else on the field, this is their third game. This is his first one back, underthrowing, overthrowing. Ellison, you just hope that you can stay in the game long enough to start finding your stride.
Third down and 15 from the 49. Heavy rush again. Ellison, ball comes out of there. Wobbly, Longoria got his feet down. Super catch by Longoria, and that's going to be a first down at the 32.
Great route right there by Ryan Longoria. Not a little quack in that eagle right there, Matt. Wasn't a lot of snap on that. I know it's just going to take him a minute. We know he can throw the ball. He has a nice arm. It's just going to take him a little minute to get back into the groove of where he left off last year, missing the first two games.
Ellison with 1,982 career rushing yards coming into tonight's ball game, over 1,700 in the air. And back to Longoria they go again. So Longoria, without a catch in their first two games, has three here in the opening 9 minutes of the game. Second down and three, ball at the 25. Eagles led the Sun Belt in scoring, total offense, and rushing offense a year ago. And Breida running hard, met just shy of the first down yardage by James Riley.
James Riley, Tevin Floyd, Mark Thomas, Mitchell Jeter. So far in this quarter and early in this game, nothing up the middle against one of the top running teams in the country, not just in the Sun Belt, but in the country in this Georgia Southern offense.
Third down and one coming up from just shy of the 22-yard line. High snap, get it to Breida. Breida is going to bull his way for the first down. And you mentioned it already, Wayne. That's one of the things that's really impressive about Breida, who's 5'10", 190. He's not just speed, and he's got plenty of that. He can also run tough between the tackles.
Yeah, hard nose, hard worker. Great in the weight room, knowing that people are expecting that his size just to be a guy that's going to take the ball and try to bounce it outside, showing you that on that 5'2 frame, it looks like it might be about 200 now instead of 195.
He's solid.
But he is a solid running back.
First and 10, just shy of the 20-yard line. Running option, now going to pass it. Heavy rush. Ellison gets rid of it before getting nailed and throws incomplete. Mark Thomas coming in there hard, as well as the linebacker Tevin Floyd, and Ellison had to get rid of it rather than take the sack.
Very fortunate right there, lobbing the ball down the middle of the field. No matter who you're playing, no matter what level you are, it's always a dangerous thing. Safeties, big-time safeties usually come up with those kind of plays. Very fortunate that actually went over the receiver's head.
Ellison, 3 for 5 to start the game, 29 yards. All three completions have gone to Longoria. And they're going to go back to Longoria again. Fourth catch by Longoria as he fights to get to the sticks and pushed out of bounds by Mario Cooper, the cornerback.
We came here thinking Georgia Southern was going to run the ball early on. They're establishing they can throw the ball with Ellison back. Nice throwing catch. Longoria having a career day already.
Yeah.
In this first quarter.
Every one of Ellison's four completions have gone to number 31, so third down and three now. Ramsby in there running back, and he's in trouble, going to reverse his direction. Wow, great run by L.A. Ramsby as he gets close to the first down. He was caught way behind the line of scrimmage and was able to squirm out of it.
This Bulldog defense is really, really getting after this big offensive line of Georgia Southern. Nothing there. Backs are trying to create things.
And now it's a fourth and one. Citadel was faced with a fourth and one, and they came up empty. Actually, theirs was more like a fourth and two. And now the Eagles facing a fourth and one from the Citadel 11 will go for it. Ramsby, first down.
Hard 1 and 2 yards inside, whether it's L.A., Ramsby, or their man Matt Breida. This defense is really stout in the middle and showing a lot of heart being undersized against this offensive line. Big pickup right there.
First and goal to go from the 9. Breida back in there at tailback. Longoria at the top of your screen if you wanted to know, since the ball seems to be going his way on every play. Breida gets the rock. Breida inside the 5 and down close to the 3.
Very interesting so far. No runs by Kevin Ellison, a guy that ran for over 1,000 yards last year.
I think he kept it once down here inside the 10.
One time for a man who really, really can run the ball. They're really trying to establish something, working that middle. You have to set things up. You just don't find out what the offense is doing until later in the game. Right now, good execution by the offensive line and the running backs.
Second down and goal from the 3. Ellison goes in motion. Breida going to take the snap himself. Breida tries to get to the outside and not going to get there as the Rover, Nick Willis, runs him down, bringing up a third down and goal, but a little wrinkle there as they go direct snap to Breida on that play, Wayne.
And you have to love the ghost block right there by Kevin Ellison. Doing the smart thing. Hey, I'm the starter quarterback. My job is just to kind of get in the way, not want to hurt him, get him hurt trying to make a block.
Sometimes that's all that needs to be done, just get in the way.
That's all you need to do. Be a shadow and make the guy think you're going to block him.
Inside the final 2 minutes of this first quarter, Ellison back taking the snap. And now Breida goes in motion. Ellison going to run it, and Ellison's going to get in. Kevin Ellison with his first touchdown of the season. And Georgia Southern has a 9-0 lead.
Kevin Ellison making me look like a genius. I was wondering when you were going to get loose, young man, running up in there hard. Big time quarterback, a lot of size so he can take the hit. Quarterback draw for this team is always dangerous when you have a talent like that at quarterback.
Hanks on for the PAT, and he pops it through. 1 yard touchdown run for Kevin Ellison, back tonight for the first time this season after missing the first two games serving an academic suspension. Gives Georgia Southern a 10-0 lead. Kevin Ellison directs a 16-play, 55-yard drive that Wayne takes a very old-school 7 minutes off the clock as Georgia Southern takes a 10-0 lead on the Citadel.
16 plays, 55 yards, 7 minutes. Usually it takes 7 minutes. You actually have to run the ball 16 times. They did it with short passing and converting on third and fourth and short.
Washington from the goal line. Bobbled it for a moment, now brings it out. And Quinlan Washington brings it up to the 24-yard line. Miles Campbell making the stop for Georgia Southern. So Citadel goes back on offense. I thought what was interesting, Wayne, is that 55-yard scoring drive came after the defense got a stop. A gift from the Citadel, dropped a first down pass. But after they got the stop, they turned it into points.
Yeah, you always want to go out when the defense rewards you with stops, whether it's turnovers or fourth and shorts, and go out and put some on the board. Already with a minute and 20 seconds in this first quarter, the Bulldogs of the Citadel are under the gun. They need to get something going before this game gets out of hand.
First and 10 from the 23. That's McField on the carry. His sixth carry of the ball game.
Evan McField. Matt, they had him listed at 6 foot 221. Maybe they had the numbers wrong because I'm looking at him. He's a nice-looking B-back. I'm talking about he's prototypical. Lot in the middle. 34 reminded me of Ironhead Hayward.
Yep. Six carries, 25 yards for McField thus far. That puts him over 200 yards for the season in their first three games. Second down. And McField again. This time he gets stopped. Very little game.
Talking about filling gaps and keeping assignments. Right there, number 16, Antonio Glover, forcing Dominic Allen to take the ball by covering his assignment. There was nowhere to pitch the ball. He had to take it. Very little yardage up in the middle on that play.
Third carry for Dominic Allen, who had rushed for 180 yards in their first two games and scored four touchdowns. Number one in the SoCon and number two in FBS or FCS. Pitch this time goes to Vinny Miller. Play gets blown up. Chris De La Rosa, the linebacker, blew up that play. It's fourth down and a three and out for the Citadel Bulldogs as the first quarter comes to a close. 15 minutes in the books in Statesboro, and the Eagles have a 10-0 lead. Lovely night, warm night in southeast Georgia. Georgia Southern 10-0 lead on the Citadel as we start the second quarter and close to a packed house here at Paulson Stadium. Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy. Start of the second quarter and fourth down in a punting situation for the Citadel Bulldogs. Will Vanvick standing at his 12-yard line to kick.
Will Vanvick on the punt.
Has to slide over to get that snap. Keaton goes back to the 22 to return. Derek Keaton down the sideline, steps out of bounds at the 35-yard line, and that's where the Eagles go back on offense.
Matt, that three and out really hurt the Citadel right there. They didn't get their defense any rest. And sometimes drives don't have to score, but they definitely need to convert a couple of first downs just to get your defense a rest, who has come out early in this game and really held tight. But if you keep sending them out there in three and out situations, they're going to wear down, especially against a massive offensive line as Georgia Southern puts on the field.
You see the true freshman, number 58, Jeremiah Culbreth. Culbreth getting the start tonight in place of the injured Max Magana. Fabian Upshaw in there at quarterback, and Upshaw cuts back, gets 3 yards on the play. Malik Diggs making the stop. But how about Culbreth in just his third college game getting the start at left tackle tonight? I'm sure that's something that you could actually relate to from your days with the Auburn Tigers.
Makes you feel like you had a long career when you had to start from the beginning. Nice looking, big fellow, 6'4", 6'3", 300-pound freshman, has a bright future.
Out of Langston Hughes High School in Atlanta, right up the middle, Wesley Fields, the freshman. Speaking of freshmen, they love this one. And Wesley Fields, another big gainer, picking up where he left off last week against Western Michigan, carries the ball inside the 30-yard line.
The Eagles been working the middle of this defense all day long. They're bringing the ball back, banging it down on that initial tackle right there. L.A. Ramsey, Breida, we have all kind of running backs out here that are showing you they have the talent and the speed on this offense to go 40, 50 yards at a clip.
Big gain for Fields, officially 25 yards, so first and 10 from the 38, Upshaw running option. And Fabian Upshaw will pick up 3 yards on the play, down to the 35. Again, Malik Diggs, the free safety, making the stop. Upshaw started the first two games for the Eagles, the loss at West Virginia, the victory over Western Michigan. That loss at West Virginia was his first start since high school.
And it's interesting that they plug him in. They brought Kevin Ellison back. I don't know whether he's injured or this was already planned to keep Fabian Upshaw in the game plan, because he's already had success and have two games under his belt.
B.J. Johnson with the catch, and a first down run for B.J. Johnson after the pass completion from Fabian Upshaw.
Last year, 2014, the Eagles ran the ball 80% of the time. So far, in at least this game, they're really showing we know how to pass. At some point in the season, we're going to have to pass. Right now, they're showing that both quarterbacks are able to step back, throw the ball, deliver it, receivers catching the ball, and get upfield.
92 yards of total offense so far for the Eagles, 56 on the ground, 46 through the air, so pretty balanced. Hand off Breida. Breida's got a lane. There he goes! Touchdown, Matt Breida. 25-yard touchdown run for Matt Breida, and it is 16 to nothing.
Matt Breida, they've been working the inside all day. When you have a guy with that kind of speed as a defense, you really have to sync up and be on the same page. Read your assignment right there, over-aggressive, down, Breida out, and once he puts that kind of speed on you, he knows how to get to the end zone.
Hanks with the PAT. And just 2.5 minutes into the second quarter, Breida finds the end zone again, his fifth touchdown run of the season. And he already has 50 yards rushing here tonight. And the Eagles are flying in Statesboro with a 17-0 lead. 17-0, Georgia Southern with a big lead on the Citadel just 2.5 minutes into the second quarter. Willie Fritz says he's seen a lot of guys chase Matt Breida, but nobody catch him as he reels off a 25-yard touchdown run. Wayne, that's 22 rushing touchdowns for Breida in his last 15 games.
A guy that, as we said in the open, can strike from anywhere on the field. Right there showing you why we talk about his speed. Able to come from over really the center and get outside. and go 25 yards untouched.
Tough and fast. Lethal combination as Washington takes it from the three. And Quinlan Washington gets up to the 20-yard line where he is brought down by James Dean and Chris De La Rosa. And so the Citadel now with some work to do here. And not an offense that's conducive to big comebacks.
Yeah, not an offense that really wants to throw the ball. We talked about it earlier. Really only wants to throw the ball about 10, 12 times a game. You get behind, you have to throw the ball. But the biggest part of this drive is to be able to give their defense any kind of break. They've had a lot of three and outs of late, and they really need to get this defense some rest.
Allen on the handoff to McField. McField pounds his way up to the 28-yard line, picks up about six or seven on the play. That gives him over 30 yards rushing. Second down and short coming up for the Bulldogs. It's hard to boil a game down to a single play, and of course it's still very early. But that dropped fourth down pass that would have moved the sticks for the Bulldogs on their second possession, how the game might be different even now had they completed that pass.
Yeah, when you're a running team and you do go for those conversions, you have to get them because you're a slow-moving, slow offense. You're trying to eat up the clock. You have to take advantage of any short field and any success you're having. Right now, running Evan McField, they've had a lot of success all day with that. That's something they might need to just hang their hat on and continue to do.
Well, as Brent Thompson, their OC, told us, we don't pass the ball often, but when we do, we want to do it well. They're 0 for 2 so far in that category in this ball game as Dom Allen keeps it and picks up 3 yards on the play.
Dom Allen has the ability to rush the ball. He's been handing it off here of late, but as a triple option quarterback, you do have to have that dynamic in your game plan. It might be something he has to, especially throwing the ball. They're going to have to get vertical.
Second down and seven from the 39. Allen replacing Aaron Miller as the Bulldogs' starting quarterback from a year ago. He's the only quarterback and only program in the Southern Conference replacing their starting quarterback this year. And the play clock runs out. That'll be delay of game penalty on the Bulldogs. Or a timeout. They called a timeout before taking the penalty. So a timeout 4 minutes into the second quarter. Bulldogs will talk. Second down coming up for the Citadel Bulldogs out of the timeout. Down 17 to nothing. Have the ball at their own 39-yard line. 438 yards per game rushing in their first two games. 65 yards on the ground here against Georgia Southern so far this evening. McField, that's a big hit by De La Rosa, the linebacker. Couple yards on the play for McField.
That's what they call a hello. I'm here. De La Rosa making a big hit right there. Trying to put this offense in a situation where they have to throw the ball. They're doing it on the scoreboard. Whenever you can make a running team have to convert third and four, third and five, it's always to your advantage. Hats off right now to this defense of the Eagles.
Bulldogs have not converted a third down or a fourth down. They're 0 for 3 on thirds, 0 for 1 on fourths. They were 69% on converting third downs in their first two games, which was number one in FCS. Playing against the FBS tonight after opening against wins over Davidson and Western Carolina, and the play gets blown dead. Delay of game.
You can't express it enough. This team is not really built to throw. Earlier, the drop on fourth and two right here, delay of game. It's a lot of thoughts going through Dominique Allen's mind when it goes to throwing the ball because it's not something they really want to do. If you look through their first two games, even last week, 69 carries. That's usually a full game, including passing. They ran the ball 69 times last week. So you have them in the situation that you want. Make them throw the ball.
On third down and nine, they do not. They run it right up the middle to McField again. And it's going to be fourth down in a punting situation for the Bulldogs again.
Evan McField on the carry.
The inability to flip the field, the inability to get enough first downs to give your defense a rest. They're really, really putting themselves, the scoreboard is already 17 to nothing. Another touchdown tacked on, and then they're really going to be in a situation that they can't really achieve greatness at, and that is throwing the ball.
Vanvick gets rid of it. Keaton will let it hit in front of him, bounces right to him. He has to field it. And Keaton going to go down about where he grabbed the ball. They'll spot it at the 13, and that's where the Eagles will put it in play when we get back. They've created quite the game day experience here at Paulson Stadium. So parents, you come to the game, what to do with the kids. They've got the Field of Dreams off behind the end zone so the kids can just run and play. And you can even bring your cheerleading outfits, and the girls can even cheerlead over there as well.
Kids playing without a video game. What? I didn't know that was possible.
You got the and you got the fans up on the embankments here as well with the blankets, kind of the picnic area, and just having a great time as the Eagles go back on offense from the 12-yard line. Breida, this is going to go. Home run for Matt Breida. His ninth touchdown run of his career of 50-plus yards. That's going to be 88.
I think somewhere in this telecast, I said Breida has the speed to go from anywhere right there. Once he gets those shoulders going, his turnover starts looking like a track run. It's just no one that can catch him. They've been working the middle of that defense. Early on, it was only 1 or 2 yards. These last couple of runs, big plays by this Eagles offense.
Hanks, 24 to nothing, Georgia Southern. Wow, Matt Breida, thunder and lightning, all in one package. Well, this was the lightning right up the middle. And it was just a race, and he's not going to lose that race. Yeah, I love it when you get that beat. Boots on stone. 24-0 Georgia Southern following an 87-yard touchdown run by Matt Breida. And Wayne, group of five, power five. I'll take Breida against any running back in the country.
Roscoe Byrd, Tommy Boynton right there. Big, huge lineman. When I saw that run, I just thought of Emmitt Smith and that old Dallas Cowboy offensive line where Emmitt was about 5'10", 205, and he would hide behind it. Big Larry Allen and Eric Williams, and then just jump out and start running. Breida catching him a breather right there. Big day already. As we said, he doesn't get a lot of touches, but when he does, he makes the most out of them. 10 carries, 137 yards, 2 TDs, can score from any distance.
Not even halfway through the second quarter, Breida has already recorded his ninth career 100-yard rushing game. Washington getting a workout on the kick return. Out to the 30-yard line, then the ball comes out. And the Bulldogs able to get on top of that thing. And the Citadel goes back on offense in a deep hole.
Trying to get as much as he can, straining to get yards. Actually, he was down, elbow hit the ground first. But that's the kind of situation this Citadel Bulldog team is in right now, being down 24 to nothing. Desperation already in this first half.
11 of the 23 meetings between these two teams prior to tonight have been decided by 10 points or less, and the last three by a touchdown or less. But the dynamic of the rivalry apparently has changed with the Eagles moving up to FBS in the Sun Belt while the Citadel remains in the Southern Conference. In fact, the very first Southern Conference game the Eagles ever played back in 1993, a 16-6 victory over this Citadel program.
Big Jay Ellison and Darius Sapp in the middle. Matt, you said this earlier, the offense last year got all the credit, but this defense was tops in the Sun Belt, and today they're playing like it once again.
Pitch. Man, Cam Jackson got walloped right there by Antonio Glover. Vinny Miller took that pitch and perhaps wishes he hadn't.
I got to take it because it's in the air, but right there, reading it so well is Antonio Glover. We spoke about this earlier. Safeties have to make the plays. They make the tackles when you run against a triple option because they're that last line of defense once everybody has taken their assignment.
Third down and 10. Allen downfield and intercepted at the 47-yard line. Darius White with the pick and returns it across the 50.
Big play by this defense. They're stopping the run. They're forcing this team to have to throw the ball, something they do not want to do. It's just not their offense. They have to throw the ball. No one really open right there. Just forcing the ball in there is Dominique Allen. Big play, Darius White on the interception.
So White with the pick sets up the offense, and the Eagles take over at the Citadel 35-yard line. Already 214 yards of offense for the Eagles, and we're halfway through the second quarter. Pass complete. Miles Campbell slips a tackle. Campbell down the sideline and finally pushed out of bounds at the 11-yard line. And a flag comes out after the tackle down the sideline by Dondre Copeland. Jason MacArthur is our referee.
Holding.
Offense, number 17. 10-yard penalty. Still first down.
Malik Henry, number 17, called for the hold right here at the bottom of your screen.
Really not needed right there. Just let the DB go. Malik trying to block, trying to hold on. To his credit, blocking hard. Big plays are always set up by blocking receivers. When you see the guy pulling away, being a former O-lineman, you just shove him off of you. Don't pull him to you. Shove him away and let his momentum trip him down. But receivers, you know, they tend to try to hold on and keep the defender close to them.
So first and four with the ball at the 29-yard line. Ramsby on the run, cuts to the outside, and Ramsby has a first down as he runs to the 20-and-a-half.
This defense is just starting to get wore down, and you can always tell when a defense is getting tired. They start missing tackles, missing assignments. Everybody on this Eagles offense, the running backs, everybody wants their number called right now. Breida, Ransby, Fields, they're raising their hand on the sideline. Put me in, coach.
First and 10 for the Eagles. Wesley Fields down to the 18-yard line. Fields, the freshman out of nearby Americus, Georgia. Option quarterback at America's Sumter High School. We saw Ramsby carry the ball a few moments ago. He was an option quarterback at Colerain High School in Cincinnati. So take those quarterbacks, as you were talking about, Wayne, and turn them into running backs. Or sometimes vice versa.
Mainly because it's hard just to go out and find a running back that knows how to run the system. It's easier to take a running quarterback from high school and transfer him to running back.
Fields gets the handoff again. Nothing doing this time for Fields as he runs in to D-tackle Mitchell Jeter.
I must say that I'm very impressed with this offensive line. I don't know if I've seen an offensive line in the country with this kind of size. I mean, it's 300 pounds across the board here at Georgia Southern. They're big. They're agile. Not so much in the pass protection, but that's not what they're called on to do a lot. You really have to see Jeremiah Colbert, that you said, the true freshman over at left tackle.
Yeah, only one returning starter on that offensive line this year, and that's the guy lined up next to Colbert, 63, Darian Foreman, the left guard. Third down and long now for the Eagles. Ellison given all kinds of time to throw. Now he's going to run it right up the middle. Makes a man miss. That's a first down for Ellison, and he's inside the 10. Did a little fake on Tevin Floyd in the open field and picks up the first.
All kinds of time. So much time, he almost gets uncomfortable. Like, where do I go? Then he remembered, oh, I can run. Nice move right there. Showing you his why he ran for 1,000 yards last year, making the linebacker miss, Kevin Ellison making a big run as this offense is starting to just take over this game.
First and goal to go, ball at the 9. Ellison keeps it that time. Little success. Joe Crochet making the tackle for the Bulldogs.
The standard, as his coach called him. He's a guy that plays every play that defensive coordinator Maurice Drayton said if he could get everybody to play that way, he'd have a whole team offense, defensive stud players.
Yeah, Wayne, not that you've been able to tell tonight with the Citadel playing up a level. But this is a defense vastly improved, at least in their first two games compared to last season. Ellison on the designed run, and Ellison gets into the end zone for the touchdown. 9-yard touchdown run for Kevin Ellison, and the route is on 30-0, Georgia Southern.
Just a little quick rollout right there, breaking the tackle of Jonathan King, showing you his strength. 6'2", 205 pounds. Happy and welcome back there, Mr. Ellison. Finding the end zone once again. Second rushing touchdown of the day.
PAT by Hanks. 31-0. So the Georgia Southern offense clicking just as it did a year ago, going 8-0 in the Sun Belt Conference with Kevin Ellison at the helm. And him back in charge tonight. Things have gone well here in the first half to the tune of a 31-0 lead. And I'll have a pizza.
And you talked about this defense of the Citadel. Through the first two games, only 10 points they gave up. But this is a different animal right here. They beat Davidson 69-0, Western Carolina 28-10. But tonight you knew it was going to be a bigger challenge, bigger players, better talent. Going on the road for their first time is this a Bulldog team.
I thought it was very interesting, Wayne, as we talked to the respective head coaches. They were doing their best to sell us on their perspective of this game. Willie Fritz telling us about how he'd shown his team all the meetings between these two teams back to 2006, how they were close and competitive. The Citadel had won some of the games. And then, of course, Mike Houston telling us, wow, this is not a fair matchup. They're FBS. We're FCS. They're an entirely different animal. Well, as we approach halftime, it looks like Mike Houston was right.
He spoke about all the way down to the facility. They have a bigger budget, able to recruit and get transfers to come to Georgia Southern. Right now is showing with their dominance.
Washington will take it at the goal line. His knee hit the ground, and was he in the end zone when it did, or was he at the 1 yard line? He was in the end zone. Wow, that was close. I don't know that he intentionally had his knee hit the ground. I think his knee just hit the ground in the process of fielding the ball here, and he was.
Yeah, I think you're right, Matt.
That was not intentional. I'm down. Yeah, you're right. That first kneel down, that was not on purpose.
And it's hard just looking at that. The bottom of the letters of the Eagles kind of threw him off, I think, as well.
Well, that was close to a disaster because if he's a yard further upfield, they're at the half-yard line.
Yes.
Instead of at the 25. And the Citadel doesn't need anything else to go wrong tonight. McField on a big run right up the middle. Matt Dobson gets him on the ground, but a first down carry for Evan McField. His 12th carry of the night. That'll put him up over 50 yards.
The one play that has been successful all night is just turn around, running the fullback hunt up the middle on the triple option. As you said, 12 carries, 60 yards there for McField.
He gets it again. And McField up to the 47. 8 yards on the play for McField. That gives him 68 in the ball game.
A running team, 31-0, is always just tough sledding. Right now, you just want to get something on the scoreboard, have some type of success before halftime.
Dominique Allen on the keeper, runs for the first down. Antoine Williams, the linebacker, making the tackle along with others. But that's a first down carry right there for the Bulldogs, who have close to 100 yards rushing in this first half and 0 yards passing. And a man down for the Eagles as well. See Allen's passing numbers tonight, including 2 interceptions and no completions. He's run the ball 5 times for 16 yards. As the clock stops with 3:06 to play in the first half. And they're tending to Robert Bryce, the backup strong safety, looking at his left ankle.
Matt, looking at those statistics, it makes you wonder is which one is the more historical, that somebody in a half only threw the ball 3 times or that they don't have any yards at it. Both of those are staggering, only 3 attempts but no yards. The one pass play that he did have very easily completed was that 4th and 2 that the tight end dropped earlier in the game.
Well, never a good sign as the medical team out there looking at Robert Bryce, and they are feeling and squeezing along that lower left leg.
Let's just hope it may be a cramp. It's still early in the season. A lot of players still haven't gotten fully. It's just cooling off here. Even in the booth, it's just cooling off. So, you know, it's hot on the field. Let's hope that it's just maybe a high ankle sprain or some kind of cramp.
Brandy Klaus, the trainer, going to assist him in getting off the field, and he can't put any weight on that left leg. Bryce, the junior out of Southwest DeKalb High School there in Decatur, Georgia, just in the Atlanta area. The longtime head coach of Southwest DeKalb, Buck Godfrey, one of the legendary coaches in the state of Georgia, having one of the stadiums there in Atlanta named after him in a ceremony tonight. They gingerly get Bryce off the field.
It's always positive when they're not playing around with your knee.
Yeah.
It's always a better sign than anything. You can kind of come back earlier from something else, but when they play with that knee right there, it looks like it's something in the calf or shin area.
So 1st and 10. Dominique Allen on the run. Antonio Glover sticks his helmet in there, but Allen gets close to 9 on the play.
They found a lot of success in the middle, even though there is a lot of size in the middle, as you can look out on the field and see with Ellis and Sapp. This offense has had a lot of success running between the tackles.
2nd down and 1, ball at the 38. And McField again, and the ball comes out, kicks deep, and scooped up by the Eagles. How about that? Just as the Citadel Bulldogs were starting to move the ball, the fumble comes out, and Riyadh Jones comes up with the loose ball, and the Eagles got it again.
Ball security, especially for your fullback who's running hard, who's had success, Evan McField right there, number 91. Lenny Hunt pulling the ball out. Probably their most successful drive so far in this game.
The ruling on the field was a fumble recovered by the defense. The play is under further review.
I believe that was Logan Hunt.
Logan Hunt.
Who popped the ball out. Riyadh Jones, a 5th-year senior out of Carver Columbus High School in Georgia by way of the University of Tennessee, where he started his career with the Volunteers, was the guy who scooped. And the play is under review to see if McField was down when the ball came out.
We never give the guy that caused the fumble enough love. Dude. We always give the guy that picked it up.
Yeah, Logan
right
Hunt was the guy who popped it out.
Logan
and
Hunt.
And Jason MacArthur is put on the headset. John Lane is our replay official up in the booth.
You always want to see your D-line follow the ball. Running back broke the line of scrimmage, but the DN, Logan Hunt, still running down the field. And that surprise. tries ripping at the ball always causes fumbles.
Let's take a look at it here.
Initially, good run right there, but Evan McPhill.
Ball clearly out.
Just out.
That's just a great tackle there by Logan Hunt, who, you know, you make that tackle and you find where that ball is and just poke it out. So the Eagles will have it at the 31-yard line. Fabian Upshaw goes back out there in the shotgun to run the offense for his second possession and second series of this first half. Brita on the handoff, 3-yard pickup. James Riley making the tackle for the Bulldogs.
Fabian Upshaw put back in the game. It could be twofold. It could be just to kind of ease Kevin Ellis into it, and it can be for next week and down the road to make a defensive coordinator have to practice for two different kind of quarterbacks.
Well, Upshaw's a guy that they usually do this. They bring him in, you know, every – you know, a couple of series in the first half. They get him in the second half, and they like to rotate him in here. Upshaw's probably the fastest guy on the team, but just behind Kevin Ellison in the quarterback battle. Did start the first two games while Ellison was out with that academic suspension. That's Tevin Floyd making the tackle right there, and now it's going to be third down as the clock continues to run late here in the first half.
Looking at Upshaw, he looks lean and tall like a receiver, actually.
Yep.
A lot of programs would have already moved him over, a la Braxton Miller.
Absolutely.
For Ohio State. But you have to have two quarterbacks in football today. Somebody has to come in quickly and be able to achieve success.
Third down, and nothing doing that time. Fourth down coming up for the Eagles. Stick around, coming up at halftime. That was Fields on the carry. Coming up at halftime, very intriguing feature on
the Citadel.
Exchange coach, Japanese coach who worked with Bob Stoops and turned that into a championship in his native land. Also, will talk to Georgia Southern president Dr. Jean Bartels, who herself is a huge football fan, big fan of the Green Bay Packers.
Aaron Rodgers, man that needs just bodies to throw the ball to.
Wow, what a game they got coming up on Sunday. We'll get her take on that as they take on the defending NFC champion Seattle Seahawks.
Matt, very interesting here that the Citadel took a timeout. It's 31-0. They haven't had a lot of success. A lot of times in these situations, you really just want to get to half and kind of get this over, retape your ankles, and try another approach coming out of halftime. Calling a time there is my timeout right there is Mike Houston. Very, very strange call.
Load up the line with 10. Matt Flynn stands at his 21 to kick. And they come after him. He punts it away to Schultz, who will take it on the fly, drops it on the ground. That's a scramble. And I believe the Citadel and Schultz got back on top of that. You know, he's kind of stuck in nowhere and no man's land in that situation, because if he doesn't field this thing, it's going to bounce about 15 yards downfield. But when you make that gamble, you better make sure you get on top of that thing.
Even me as an ex-O lineman has always heard the special team coach tell you that if you're not clearly in front of the ball, it's almost like a shortstop. You got to get your body in front of the ball right there, reaching for the ball always can cause problems. And they don't need any more. They don't give Georgia Southern any more opportunities to score.
Well, down to our final 49 seconds here in the first half. ...127 yards on the ground for the Citadel in the first half, and none in the air. That's Cam Jackson. Cam Jackson with his first carry of the night. He's the backup quarterback and a first-team A-back and a flag out.
Cam Jackson on the carry. There is a flag on the play.
Expect the call from James
MacArthur. Flag dropped in the backfield.
Cam Jackson getting his first touch of the game. Last week was a bigger part of the offense. This week, not so much.
Personal foul. Clipping, number 57, offense. Half the distance to the goal. Still first down.
It's Kyle Weaver, the left guard. So the Bulldogs take a big loss on the clipping call right here, and that pushes it back to the 11-yard line.
You only have so much area where you can actually throw that block. Sometimes you're not aware that you're that far out of the box even try to cut the D lineman down.
And again, not that you have seen it tonight, but Mike Houston believes one of the biggest improvements in his offense this year compared to last is in his offensive line.
All five starters returned this year.
Dominique Allen on the run up to the 19-yard line goes Allen.
He is taken down by DeShonte Gallon for the Eagles.
And some people might be wondering, why aren't they a hurry-up offense? Why aren't they throwing the ball? They're not really built to go four or five wide and throw the ball around. They make their hay by running the ball.
McField crashes up to the 28. Might have been the final play of the half right there. And a strong first half. Evan McField up over 90 yards rushing in the first 30 minutes, but his team's down 31-0.
The long bright spot for this Bulldog team.
Well, the first half belongs to the Georgia Southern Eagles. 264 yards of total offense, 202 on the ground. 140 of that belonged to Matt Breida, who had an 87-yard touchdown run to highlight the first two quarters. 31-0 Georgia Southern at the break.
You're all excited to book that vacation flight. Plenty of seats to choose from, right? But the minute you try to use reward miles from your airline credit card, it's slim pickings. The flight you want, sorry, they ask for a ridiculous number of miles. Time to switch to the Capital One Venture card. With Venture, you'll earn unlimited double miles. And using those miles is easy. Just book any flight you want on any airline, then use your miles to cover the cost. No blackout dates. What's in your world?
Halftime in Statesboro, Georgia. You're watching the Capital One Halftime Report. You've heard of exchange students. How about exchange coaches? Here's the story from Norman, Oklahoma.
It's a long way from the ancient temples of the Far East to the plains of the Midwest, from Norman, Oklahoma to Kyoto, Japan. But one man and one game connect the two in a way that's changed both.
This is a ball from Sunas. They gave me. And this is playbook, the old one, but secret one.
胸出しすぎ.
Isao Hashizume is the wide receivers coach for the Ritsumeikan Panthers, a college football team in Japan. But 15 years ago, he traveled 6,000 miles away to Norman, Oklahoma, to spend the entire season studying with the Sooners coaching staff.
They told me that he had come over from Japan and he was asking if he could be around and watch and observe the program, which I scratched my head and was unsure about that.
He was very quiet, paid attention to everything, was a good listener, took great notes. But, you know, as we got to know him, as time went on, He became one of us.
I remember one day Coach Mangino put him on the board, you know, in front of the team to go through 92, one of our routes. He drew it up perfectly, and the players loved it.
Through the season, Esau also learned about some of the other aspects of American college life.
There's a place that he liked to frequent occasionally. It's called the library here, and it's not really one of those places that you go read a lot of books.
試合が終わるとよくコーチたちが飲みに行ったりするんで、そこに連れてってもらって一緒にバドワイザービールを飲んでました。Well,
there was a time or two we might have had a couple Budweisers. As Esau used to say he liked his Budweiser.
During a magical 2000 season, Esau was there, in the shadows of coaches' boxes, soaking it in, a season that ended with a title. And Bob Stoops wanted Esau to know he was a part of it.
He needs to have a championship ring like the rest of us. He was with us through it all.
Speed on.
After the season, Esau returned home, and with the lessons he learned in Norman, he turned the Ritsumeikan Panthers into the Sooners of Japan. Under Esau's offensive guidance, the Panthers won the national championship in 2002 and 2003. And to show his gratitude to Coach Stoops, Esau sent him a ring of his own.
I was elated to get it. I showed everybody. I've got it in my box with all my other bowl rings and championship rings.
Sooners football is America だけじゃなくて日本でも日本一になれるあのプログラムでしたよっていう報告をしました。
This season, Esau is still coaching the Panthers and still wearing the memories from 6,000 miles east.
I'm glad it's worked out so well for him and he's done so well, and he's the master coach now, so he's won more championships than me, so I might have to go visit him.
It's the Capital One Halftime Report, the Citadel. You're watching the Capital One Halftime Report, and we are at the break in Statesboro, Georgia. The sun is setting here in southeast Georgia, and the Georgia Southern Eagles with a stout 31-0 lead on the Citadel Bulldogs. It's our pleasure to welcome in school president Dr. Gene Bartels, and congratulations. Look at you. You're just 4 months on the job and a big 31-0 lead at halftime. Couldn't ask for better, could you?
Not too bad. It's a first start.
For a career academician and a huge football fan, being the president of Georgia Southern's got to be a treat.
It's a tremendous treat. Our football program has been stellar and very much attrition of the institution and really our front door. And it really well loved by everybody in the area.
You took over the presidency here at Georgia Southern back in early summer, and you got your true baptism as the president of Georgia Southern by taking a dip in Eagle Creek.
Beautiful Eagle Creek. It was a tradition for our seniors to always be baptized there during their last season, and the new presidents get to do that as well. I couldn't let that opportunity pass. I'm a nurse by background. Many people thought that I should have known better, but it was a wonderful experience and had a really great time.
None the worse for wear because you're here today and you're fine, but kind of give us the story of Dr. Gene Bartels and how you arrive at Georgia Southern. You're from Wisconsin, so you're a big Green Bay Packers fan, so you know about football tradition, but obviously the job is more than just football tradition.
Right. I actually came to Georgia Southern in 1999 and to chair the School of Nursing. We have an outstanding nursing program here, and it was a real draw for me to come from Wisconsin down to run that program. From that point, I became the dean of the College of Health and Human Sciences in which the School of Nursing resided, then became the provost and vice president of academic affairs most recently. So I had the opportunity to look at academics across the entire institution. President now.
Well, if the football team continues to do their job and do as expected, you'll be the president when the Georgia Southern Eagles play in their first ever bowl game. That should happen this season. What else is on the agenda for you in your office?
Well, I'll just say, I'll just backtrack on that just for a minute, because I'm the first woman president for Georgia Southern University in 110 years. I will also be the first woman president to go with them to the bowl game. So that's my plan. Told them that that's what I had hoped to happen. Beyond that, though, we will be in the search for a permanent president for the institution this fall. We are moving forward. Many academic programs that are being developed and expanded. We're starting manufacturing engineering this year. It's one of our premier programs. Engineering programs are doing really well. Nursing programs doing fine. And we're moving forward.
Dr. Gene Bartels, thanks a lot for visiting with us.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
All right, there you go. Georgia Southern, a big 31-0 lead on the Citadel. Capital One halftime report continues in just a moment with the first half. Capital One halftime report continues from Paulson Stadium in Statesboro, Georgia, where the Georgia Southern Eagles hold a huge 31-0 lead on the Citadel Bulldogs. Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy at halftime. And what an impressive first half for the Georgia Southern Eagles offensively and defensively. And Matt Breida certainly lives up to the billing, and breaks off an 87-yard touchdown run to highlight that first half.
Actually makes our job easy when we can come in, talk about a guy early on, and then he delivers the kind of performance that Matt Breida actually put out there, showing you just like we talked about, I'm 5 yards, I'm 10 yards, I'm 80 yards. If you need me to be, what a dynamic running back.
And certainly the rivalry has changed with the Georgia Southern Eagles moving up to FBS and the Sun Belt Conference. Let's take a look back at those first half highlights and the, you know, Eagles first possession. They got that interception and they got held to a field goal on after that first interception. And that was really an early victory for Citadel. But then Kevin Ellison and the Georgia Southern Eagles got on track there, and Matt Breida started breaking off some big runs.
Yeah, they kept working the middle. It was 1 yard, it was 2 yards, and then it started being 50 and 60. Matt Breida from all kinds of distances. Kevin Ellis converting a couple of short touchdown runs. The running game of this team, even though they threw the ball early, started to come on late in the half.
Yeah, Ellison 52 yards passing, 18 yards rushing, Breida 140 yards rushing, 202 yards on the ground for Georgia Southern. Citadel got 144, but when you don't convert it into points, it's kind of a hollow victory.
Yeah, early on, they really, when you see penalties are kind of even, time of possession is kind of even, third down conversion way on the tilted to the side of the Eagles. Just something they have to be able to do to keep their defense fresh.
And it's halftime. At halftime, it's Georgia Southern with a 31-0 lead on the Citadel Bulldogs. We'll come back and start the second half in just a moment.
After 9.5 years of service to my country.
In college football. Take a guess.
Anybody? Anybody? I'll give you a hint. It's the playoff.
It's only the second year. It's shiny and new like a little baby that I invented.
Oh, you invented it?
Yeah. Yeah, I did.
All right.
Did you watch last year?
Third string QB took home the trophy. Third string, that's you guys.
You don't know what's going to happen in that playoff. I can't wait.
Aren't you supposed to be working or something?
Yeah, I am.
Ice cold, Dr. Bob here.
That look regulation to you? I think it needs more air.
Georgia Southern 31-0 lead on the Citadel as we get ready to start the third quarter here at Paulson Stadium. Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy as the Eagles look for their second win of the season and better than halfway there with their huge lead. Goins with the kickoff taken by Keaton at the 5 yard line. Keaton A lot of dancing by Derek Keaton to get that ball out to the 35-yard line. 30-yard return by Derek Keaton. That's where the Eagles start the second half.
You can take over first and 10.
Nothing where the initial blocking is. A lot of speed on this Georgia Southern team. Moving, a lot of movement, not many yards, but way to make something out of nothing right there. When you have the kind of speed that these players possess on Georgia Southern, it's okay for them to take gambles here and there.
Matt Breida, 12 carries, 140 and two touchdowns already tonight as we start this third quarter. Went for 176 on just 11 touches last week against Western Michigan. Wesley Fields will get the first carry, however, in the third quarter. Fields with four carries and 26 yards with that carry right there. Brings down a second down and eight. Ellison with 10 100-yard rushing games himself in his career. Six carries for 18 yards in the first half. Ball batted up in the air, and Keaton comes up with it and will take a big loss.
Bad play there by Derek Keaton. Ball batted in the air. You have no blocking. You're running backwards. Just knocked the ball down. And right here, you catch the ball. Nice play there by the defensive end, Mark Thomas. But that's just a bad play right there by Derek Keaton.
Yeah, you need to have the presence of mind just to knock the ball down, kind of like a volleyball. Just knock it to the ground.
Toss it in the stand somewhere.
Take an incompletion. As it is, it turns into a big loss right there. Third down now. And 22. Ellison being chased by Thomas, gets rid of it, has nowhere to go with it. And it's going to be fourth down as he throws it away.
Citadel, nice three and out right there to start the second half coming out. Just like they started the game, the defense for them, the first quarter was holding up very well. It just was too many three and outs by the offense, kept them out on the field a long time. And after that 16-play, 55-yard drive, we spoke about the ending of the touchdown. It seemed like the dam just kind of broke from that point, and fatigue started setting in, at least initially right now. They're back playing how he did early in the game.
Ryan Nowicki on the punt here for the Eagles. He's standing at the 8-yard line. He had been beaten out by Matt Flynn for the number one punting job, but Nowicki getting the chance, the veteran, to let it fly. Schultz calls a fair catch and takes it at the 33-yard line. That's where the Bulldogs will be on offense for the first time when we get back. Nothing Georgia Southern as the Citadel goes on offense for the first time here in the second half. Bulldogs wearing their dress white uniforms tonight. These uniforms patterned after the dress whites that the cadets wear on campus and on special occasions there at the Citadel. McField on the carry, and McField picks up about 3, maybe 4 yards up to the 36-37-yard line. But that was one of the things we talked to head coach Mike Houston about, just how jam-packed the cadets and the football players' days are on campus. It is not your typical college football player kind of day.
Not when the easiest part of the day is going to practice. He said that most of the players are up at 6. They're not back to their bed till 11:30 at night, a full day. A full regiment for this team that – you know, being a cadet is much, much harder than being a football player. But that discipline that they all learn as a cadet definitely helps them on the football field.
Yeah, actually the football, as you mentioned, is kind of a break from the everyday routine, especially for freshmen and sophomores. When you're a freshman and sophomore on campus, you're low man on the totem pole. There is definitely a class system weighted heavily in favor of the upperclassmen. But on the football field, if you're a freshman and you beat out a senior, you win the job. Big run up the middle for McField. Evan McField off to the races, and he is going to get into the end zone for the touchdown.
McField on the carry for a
So they've been pounding that rock all night long, right up the middle, and finally Evan McField cracks it with a 60-yard touchdown run.
McField is the one who has been running the same fullback hunt up the middle all night. It started off 3, 4, 7 yards here for a big fella, showing you a lot of speed out in the open field. Matt Breather, who I have speed as well. I don't think none of us was expecting that type of distance from a back that big.
And that's an example of what we were talking about right there as Goins is on for the PAT. And he puts it through to make it 31-7. But Evan McField, who is a redshirt freshman, a low man on the totem pole on campus, a big man on campus on the football field as he rumbles 60 yards to the score. And the Bulldogs finally get on the board. It's like you've been waiting on the – 31-7 Georgia Southern as the Bulldogs finally get on the board here in the opening 3 minutes of the third quarter. And it was that man right there who is now the leading rusher in this game with 17 carries for 161. Nearly as many yards rushing here tonight against the Eagles as he had in his first two games combined. Just reeled off a 60-yard touchdown run to get the Citadel on the board.
Something tells me there was a full metal jacket type speech at halftime by Mike Houston. Great run there by Evan McField.
Goins kicks off, and Keaton will not be able to return this one. And the Eagles will start at the 25-yard line.
Just what this Bulldog team needed, not just a three and out, but an effective drive that showed what they are capable of running the ball. They are explosive. I don't think none of us thought McFields would be the B-back running a touchdown that far, but they are an explosive running team. That's how they make their living. And to see them come out in this second half and be down 31-0 and still show that heart, as you spoke as we came back from break about them being cadets, that is how they approach the game. That's how Mike Houston and his team goes about their business.
Evan McField showed us a little giddy up on that 60-yard run, and now the Eagles back out on offense. B.J. Johnson in motion behind the line, and the handoff. Wesley Fields on the carry right there. Jonathan King, the defensive tackle, making the stop for the Bulldogs. Jonathan King, the sophomore out of Statesville, North Carolina. He's the youngster on that defensive line that's pretty veteran with Thomas the senior, Jeter the senior, and Crochet the junior. Too many players in the backfield. The call against Georgia Southern, so the 5-yard markoff makes it 1st and 15, and the Eagles off to a little bit of a slow start here in this third quarter.
Yeah, I know you're comfortable on the scoreboard. It's 31-7, but with Ellison just coming back, you really need to build some continuity. You need to keep playing at least into the fourth, trying to get all the players on the page with him.
Breida, spin move, dropped at the 24-yard line. Joe Crochet making the tackle right there. Eagles have their conference opener coming up next Saturday. In fact, they'll probably have to leave tomorrow, just joking, but it is at Idaho, which is a tough place to get to from Statesboro, Georgia.
Yeah, you got a couple of connections to get into Idaho, but they need to. They have a lot of conference games coming up in their last 9 games. I think 7 of them are in conference, so they need to get this rhythm of Ellison being back going.
Ramsby with the catch, dances out there in the open field and gets dropped at the 30-yard line. Pick up a 5 on the play. Malik Diggs, the free safety, making that stop. Going to bring up a 3rd down and a long 5 coming up for the Eagles. Crochet, the standard. We talked about him earlier. He was their defensive player of the year a year ago out of Stone Mountain, Georgia, and St. Pius Catholic School in the Atlanta area. Downfield they go, and that is caught by Miles Campbell for a 1st down right at the 50-yard line.
Earlier in the game, I don't know if Kevin Ellison could have completed this pass. He seems to be gaining a little rhythm. Early early passes were short. Right here, he steps into the throw. He went from a wounded eagle earlier in the game, right there throwing a strike to Miles Campbell. Nice throw, nice route by Miles Campbell.
Eighth completion of the night for Ellison. Four have gone to Longoria, and two have gone to Campbell. Those six catches, both of them, their first of the season for both Longoria, who just makes his fifth catch on a bubble screen. And Campbell, who just had the previous catch, was out there blocking for him.
Bubble screens are really just, I think my athlete is better than your athlete. I'm going to get in the ball and see who wins that battle. So far in this game, Ryan Longoria has made that play big for this offense, getting 4, 5, 8 yards every time he touches it.
Yeah, Longoria had only one catch last year in his first season with the Eagles before he got hurt, after being a star wide receiver at Fullerton College out in California. That's Ramsby. And a first down carry for L.A. Ramsby.
That's been the bread and butter play all day, right up the middle. Just a quick read by the quarterback. Two defenders sitting there staring the quarterback in the eyes. Ellison, knowing that he has the ability, he's handing it off. That play has been there all night long.
That's going to put the Eagles at close to 300 yards rushing on the night. First and 10 from the 28.
Handoff goes to number one, L.A. Ramsby.
Ramsby picks up three on that play.
Jordan Southern knows that weight and size wise, their offensive line can wear on this defensive line. It's obvious just looking out on the field. There's 300 pounders are basically against 260 pounders, and they're steadily just wearing on them with that inside run.
Ellison spins and throws to the outside. Keaton gets separated from the ball. A big hit out there by the quarterback, D. Delaney.
Nice throw, nice route, a little high right there by Ellison. Actually, Derek Keaton had Delaney beat, still working on the play. Delaney to push him out of bounds, nice hit. Nice recovery by him.
Brings up third down and seven now from the 25.
We haven't seen much pressure as far as blitzes go against Kevin Ellison, and that's just because he can come out of it with his feet and make something big happen.
Fields on the screen, and Wesley Fields dragged down from behind by Diggs, but Fields gets enough for the first down.
What a comfort to have as a quarterback. I have Ramsey, Keaton, Fields, Matt Breida, all guys. If I can just get them the ball in open space, it's an 8 to 10 yard game.
Wesley Fields goes to the sideline. First and 10 for the Eagles from the 15 yard line. Breida comes to the short side. Breida steps out of bounds. We'll see where they spot it. 11-yard line. Pick up about five on the play for Breida as he just keeps adding to his total.
Holding. Number 77, offense. 10-yard penalty.
Still first down.
That'll go against Tommy Boynton, the sophomore right tackle out of Jacksonville, Florida.
Only the fifth penalty in this game. It's been a pretty good, clean game between both teams. The best part of this drive, Matt, so far is just the response of Georgia Southern to the Citadel coming out and scoring. They came out three and out. Citadel goes down and score. They have had a successful drive, not only eating up the clock, but threatening to score.
So first and 20 now from the 26. Ellison under pressure, and that ball is going to be intercepted at the 6-yard line. Ellison got clobbered. He is still down on the field. Malik Diggs with the interception, but the bigger issue for the Eagles right now is Ellison is down. He got sandwiched right as he threw.
James Riley, number 49, number 5, Joe Crochet meeting at the quarterback. As they say, really sandwiching him. And this is his first game back. This could be a serious injury, or it could be just simply a big hit on your first game back, which is, you know, it takes a minute for your body to adjust to just being hit.
You see Willie Fritz shaking his head. Last thing you want to see is Kevin Ellison get hurt in any situation, but especially with a 24-point lead in a game that you are solidly in command. Let's take a look at it.
Joe Crochet not buying the fake at all.
Man, they hit him at the same time.
And they caught him right in the middle. Malik Diggs, just Johnny on the spot right there. Ball in the air, safety making a play. Big stop right there by this defense. That holding call really threw the timing off as his offense was dominating.
So they get Ellison to the sideline. We'll effort to make sure we get an update on his condition. And the play is under review.
Something must have happened at the end right there as Malik Diggs caught the ball. Maybe it screwed it out. It looked like a clean interception initially.
It appears that, Georgia Southern still has the ball.
It's right here, ball in the air. It slipped down his numbers. Through his arm, are they saying the tip of the ball hit the ground as he tried to?
Yeah, they must have ruled on the field that the ball hit the ground.
Here's another angle of it. Oh, it did right there, Matt. You can see the ball between his knees. And then he just curled up to try to sell that he actually, good job by him to even make it. reviewable, because right there from that angle, it's clear the ball just ran down the middle of his chest and hit the ground before he was able to secure it.
So it appears the Georgia Southern Eagles will retain possession.
After review, the running on the field is confirmed. It's an incomplete pass.
It is an incomplete pass, confirmed by replay. And so Kevin Ellison comes out of the ball game. And he doesn't look too good right now.
From the play, it looks like he just kind of got caught in the chest between two players. He's not touching his head or having an eye exam. He's standing up. This is his first game back. And as I tell people, it takes about three games for your body to actually be conditioned to take just regular playing hits. Let's hope he can get back in this game soon.
Yeah, so second down and 20 now, and Fabian Upshaw in there at quarterback. And he'll hand off to Breida. Breida cracks through the line, sprints, and he had the ball knocked out of his hands, and it went backwards and out of bounds at the 6. Fortunately for Breida, one of the few and very rare mistakes that he makes. Fumbled the ball, but the Eagles will retain possession and have it first and goal.
Let's stop all that throwing, Matt says. Matt Breida says, give me the ball. Being a little careless at the end, trying to seek the end zone. Nice big run once again. Not a lot of touches, but it's 8, 10, 12-yard average every time he gets the ball in his hand.
He is a dynamic running back. He is on all the watch lists for the big running back awards in the nation. I know they're a group of five. They're Sun Belt. But, man, it's hard to imagine there's any running backs that are that much better than he is at any level of the game, whether it's Power 5 or Group of 5. They're going to measure now that the ball got knocked backwards. I had gone ahead and said it was a first down, but he might not be there after all.
One thing you can't measure in this game at the running back position is vision. No matter what level you're on, your vision is your vision, regardless of your height or your weight or your speed. And he's shown you on these runs, he seeks the hole. He actually sees blocks and blockers coming over and able to time it to make those cuts. He's a big-time running back. He's one of those guys that really fall into the third round to a team, and next thing you know, you're calling his name every day on Sunday.
So they're going to be a yard short. So that fumble by Breida backwards and out of bounds turned out to be very costly, because it appeared that his feet got beyond the sticks, but he didn't have the ball when his feet got beyond the sticks. So it's going to be third down and 1 now from the 6.
situation they've been in tonight. They've been good at converting high percentage, about 6 for 9 they are tonight on third down conversions. This offense is definitely suited with a line that big to convert third and ones.
Upshaw still in there at quarterback after Ellison got shaken up. Ramsby with the carry, and I don't know that Ramsby got there. Big defensive play by the Bulldogs, led, I believe, by the linebacker Riley. And it may be fourth and short coming up.
High snaps when you're in the pistol. Any kind of shotgun really throws off the timing. While the quarterback is trying to corral the ball, everybody's already moving. And then next thing you know, the hole is closed. So something that you think is simple becomes big.
So fourth down and one. Ramsby in there, along with Upshaw. And Rediger, the H-back, lined up next to Upshaw to block. And Ramsby, first down and more. That's a touchdown. They get the 1 plus 5. 6 yards for the score, and it's 37-7.
Third and one, we tried to cut you on the left. Fourth and one, we decided we'll just try to cut you on the right. A play just like with the Citadel. Both teams have just been working that between the tackle space. Big run there by L.A. Rams.
Alex Hanks for the PAT. Once again, perfect. 38-7, Georgia Southern. 12 plays, 75 yards, 5.5 minutes. Ramsby takes it in. And the Eagles get back that touchdown. Stomp your feet. It's like you've been waiting on the Another big long drive for the Georgia Southern Eagles. Earlier, a 16-play drive. This is a 12-play drive as they run it and pass it 75 yards for the score, Wayne.
Been a very balanced offensive attack tonight. Early in the game, they threw a little more than they ran, and then the running started catching up. Breida making big plays, and this man, L.A. Ramsey, running it in. It's funny, he's only 210 pounds.
Only.
But he's the big back out of all these backs. 12 plays, 75 yards, 5 minutes and 30. That's been kind of the drives they've had. They've been long. They've either been 12 or 15 plays, or they've been 2 plays.
Look at the guns on that guy. He was an option quarterback in high school.
Yeah, those guns aren't optional. I don't know. Me and you have been curling a long time and never got that kind of cut.
Good for stiff arming, forearm shivers. So 38-7, Georgia Southern, well on their way to their second victory of the season after dropping their opener at West Virginia, and then beating Western Michigan last week. And then they travel to Idaho next week. Washington will take from the 2. Raekwon Sam making the tackle in the open field.
The unit we haven't spoke a lot about tonight has been this defense of Deshante Gallen and Matt Dobson, Antonio Glover. But they really, I mean, other than that, the first drive of the second half, they have dominated this game in the air, on conversion. They really have had this team. They've given up a couple of big runs in there, but for the most part, they've held everything that the Citadel wants to do in check.
So first and 10 for the Bulldogs from the 27, again down by 31. McPhee, nothing doing that time. Big old Jay Ellison making the tackle, his fourth tackle of the night. Up on that defensive line, number 54, Lenny Richardson lining up at left defensive end. It's Military Appreciation Day here at Paulson Stadium. He spent 4 years in the Army. He was a gunner. He was a tank gunner in the Army, served in Korea, and then at Fort Benning, Georgia. He actually started his career. Ball is fumbled, and it is recovered by Georgia Southern at the 27-yard line.
Antonio Glover once again being the man on the spot early on, making big hits right there, just being in the right reads. These safeties have read and lined up. The best thing I've seen with this defense is how they just keep stringing along. Other than the couple of runs in the middle, when they go to try to pitch on the edge, if you can see right there, everybody's in a lane, nowhere to go with the ball.
And look at that. Antonio Glover hopped on the ball right in front of our man, Lenny Richardson. Look at Lenny, number 54. He's got a fumble, man. He's a senior. He's 27 years old. He's had two shoulder surgeries, and Glover went in there and took his glory from him.
And Lenny is down there telling him, hey, man, I was going to pick it up and score.
I was going to scoop and score for my kids. He's got three kids. Of course, like I said, he is 27 years old already, not your typical senior. Pass downfield, incomplete. Malik Henry, the intended target. But Lenny Richardson's a great story. Just to wrap that up and put a bow on it, Willie Fritz said, you know, the kids really respect him. They gave him a standing ovation at the start of preseason camp. But he's not too old that he doesn't relate to the kids, but he's older than a lot of Willie Fritz's grad assistants.
And I'm quite sure he captivates them with some of the stories that he might tell or share with them, or just being over there and basically telling them, you think this is hard? Let me tell you about hard. Hats off to him and all our troops.
Ellison's back out there at quarterback now. And at halftime of tonight's ball game, they had a big swearing-in ceremony for the new soldiers here in Southeast Georgia.
25 soldiers. I met Captain Cruz earlier today at the hotel. He was proud. He's been 18 years. He graduated from the University of Miami. He brought up names like Ray Lewis and stuff, which started to make me mad, Warren Sapp. But hats off to you, Captain Cruz, and 25 people who joined the military this year.
Thanks for serving our country. Third down now for the Eagles. Ellison throws. Henry can't hold on. Henry tried to run before he had it.
He's
going to be fourth down.
Third and eight right there. They've been better getting the ball to the backs in these situations and letting the backs go get the 8 yards. But as we all know down the road, especially as they start taking on Appalachian State and those people down the road, they're going to need to be able to do it both ways, air and by lane.
The 40-yard field goal.
Well, Hanks already has one field goal tonight, their first score of the night. Now this will be a 41-yard attempt from the left hash mark. And that kick is good. 41-yard kick for Alex Hanks. And Georgia Southern has topped 40 for the second consecutive game as now they lead 41-7. So Alex Hanks with his second field goal of the night. You know, he splits kicking duties on this Georgia Southern team with Youngway Koo, who is a junior out of New Jersey. There he is right there. He'll sometimes kick off for the Georgia Southern Eagles. Watch what Youngway was doing during the offseason here. Wow.
I was looking, trying to figure out what was he going to do special. I did not expect a flip and a kick at the same time. What an athlete. We might need to get him in the backfield and see whether he can run the ball with that kind of athletic ability. Matt,
I have to tell you. I can't do either one of those. I can't do the flip, nor can I kick the ball through the upright. So I'm doubly impressed.
I missed the flip at about six. I lost all my flip ability. So.
Well, a successful night for Willie Fritz and the Georgia Southern Eagles. He will improve to 7-0 in his career here at Paulson Stadium. And what a hire by the Georgia Southern program to bring Willie Fritz here after Jeff Monken left for the Army. And they brought in Willie Fritz from Sam Houston State, where he had led the program to two national championship games. And him joining the program along with the move to the Sun Belt Conference, just been golden, just been perfect. Return by Washington right there. They get him on the ground at the 25-yard line. And that's where the Bulldogs will go back on offense. And what an accomplished resume for Willie Fritz. 23 seasons as a head coach at Blinn, back before Cam Newton ever made it famous. He won two national championships. Central Missouri, he's the all-time winningest coach in Mules history. I'm not kidding. They're called the Central Missouri Mules. And Sam Houston, look at that, 40-15 in 4 years, two national championship games, and he has just continued his success here at Georgia Southern.
And usually when you move up a division, people start thinking, oh, we're going to struggle to go into the Sun Belt, go 8-0 in the conference in your first year. Hats off to Willie Fritz.
Wow. Big stick right there as Allen runs the ball.
Allen on the quarterback.
Number 27, Deshante Gallen. Coach spoke highly of him about his feet, his speed, his athletic ability. Said for a linebacker, he has more safety height, but he can come up and hit. He does have range. Big hit right there.
Gallen with his sixth tackle of the night as you take a look or took a look there at the six national championship banners, the last coming in 2000 under Paul Johnson, now the head coach at Georgia Tech. And there's another big stick by the Eagles that turn up the volume here on defense.
It's all about the fit when you go in and try to stop the option. Everybody has to fit, as you can see right there, and out of nowhere, a blur comes in.
And that is the true freshman, Joshua Moon, out of Creekside High School in the Atlanta area with the quarterback sack.
I don't even think Dominique Allen saw where he came from. He hadn't even got around to that read. What a play by Moon right there.
Yeah, that doesn't officially count as a quarterback sack, although they got him behind the line of scrimmage right there. It was a big hit, though, and it's going to be a hit in the film room session as well.
It's definitely the kind of hit that'll get you more time on the field as Moon, as you say, as a freshman.
Well, Willie Fritz was just in love with Joshua Moon. We talked about him the other day. They really are impressed with him. Wesley Fields, a couple of freshmen who, you know, they step on campus and they're making immediate impacts right away. They're going to have big futures in this program. Fourth down punting situation. One thing I wanted to add there, you were talking about, you know, Georgia Southern going 8-0 in their first year in the Sun Belt. Heavy rush as Van Vick gets it away. Keaton runs away from it. It's going to kick out of bounds. But that 8-0 record and 9-3 record overall for Georgia Southern, that was the most wins ever for a first-year Sun Belt Conference program. And it was the lowest ever predicted finish for a team that ended up winning the championship. They were expected to finish eighth in the conference last year.
And 9-3 and no bowl. Is that correct? I was thinking maybe my media was wrong.
They didn't qualify because they were in the second year. You got to go through a 2-year transition of going to the going to FBS, and so they did not, even though certainly they were bowl eligible as conference champions.
Yes.
They just by NCAA rule and law, they were not eligible to participate in a bowl. Although they did petition to have that rule waived, they did not win that argument.
Willie Fritz, send me to. I should have been on that petition.
Yeah. Well, so
wins are wins. I don't know where you have these things where we got to be somewhere other than on the field and show what we can do.
Well, the goal this year is to play a 13th game. In other words, to play in a bowl game this year. Clock winding down here in the third quarter. Upshaw in there running option. He's going to take the lick, and Upshaw goes down at the 38-yard line. Miles Pierce, the linebacker, making the stop. As you take a look at the schedule for the Georgia Southern Eagles, as we mentioned, they got the long road trip coming up next Saturday as they will be at Idaho and then at UL Monroe. And their next home game will not be for close to a month, as they will not play here at Paulson Stadium until October 17th as they welcome in the New Mexico State Aggies. And then they've got a big Thursday night game, back-to-back games, as a matter of fact, on the U at App State and then here hosting Texas State. Third down, Upshaw to the air, long throw out to the far side is complete, and that's a first down. Ball comes out. I think they're going to rule that it was down after, I think it was B.J. Johnson or Malik Henry who made the catch.
That game with UL Monroe should be exciting with Matt Breida on one side and Rashawn Caesar on the other. Talking about big play ability.
You see the predicted order of finish in the Sun Belt this year. That was Malik Henry with the catch, and ball was out as he was going down. It will stand as a catch. I thought it was Malik Henry. Maybe it was B.J. Johnson. Ramsby on the run. He's got a first down and more as he gets to the far sideline.
One thing I like about this Georgia Southern team, they have depth at position, especially on the offensive side. They got two quarterbacks. They got four running backs. They have aggressive receivers when they get the ball in their hand. Everybody, you can see a lot of athleticism when they get the ball, that they can actually run. They have speed. I don't know if there's a slow back on the roster, that they all get in and they all have that burst to get around the corner and get big chunks of yards.
Final half minute of the third quarter. Ramsby. And the ball is out this time. Let's see if the Citadel has covered. No indication yet from Jason MacArthur. And apparently the Eagles have
recovered by the offense after the
retained possession.
Second down.
So the Eagles got back on top of that thing. Looks like that was the final play of the third quarter.
Only negative tonight offensively is a couple of times they put the ball on the ground. They've been able to keep the ball. But eventually things like that will catch up with you.
That is the end of the third quarter. Georgia Southern rolling in this 24th all-time meeting against their former SoCon rivals. 41-7 Georgia Southern as we head to the fourth. Georgia Southern leading the Citadel as we head to the fourth quarter. The students enjoying the game, and you're listening to one of the former students and graduate of Georgia Southern, Luke Bryan, class of 1999. As we head to the fourth quarter, Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy. Second down and long for the Eagles as Upshaw takes the snap, gives it to Wesley Fields. He slips out of one tackle, gets out of another. First down carry for Wesley Fields.
Whether it's Fields, whether it's Breida, whether it's Keaton, all of them have that burst, and all of them to be small backs are very strong and have a good balance. If you don't look at the numbers, sometimes you think it's the same guy running the ball. That's how explosive all four of them are.
Willie Fritz says he's going to be a great player and probably one of the most mature freshmen that he's ever coached. In fact, Fields, kind of to your point, reminds him a lot of Matt Breida. There goes Fields again inside the 10-yard line.
Great coaches always go out and look for the same person. It's like you're trying to really recycle somebody you already have because they fit right into the scheme that you want to run. Fields definitely looks like Breida sometimes, without doubt.
Second and short. Fields that time runs into the waiting arms of James Riley, who makes his 11th tackle of the night. Fields committed to Middle Tennessee when he was a senior at America Sumter High School and flipped to Georgia Southern.
He's a third down and one for Georgia Southern.
I'm quite sure he's happy he's made that choice coming out here as a true freshman. Really a big part of the offense, not one of those just in there because the game is a blowout. He's been out there all night contributing.
Yeah, Fritz was very complimentary that Fields was able to get a mental rep when he's out on the when he's on the sideline. He's able to watch Breida and watch what he does and go out there and emulate it as he emulates Breida and picks up the first down right there. First and goal to go for the Eagles.
Nice cut, nice hard 2 yards. Most people just look at that and just see the 2 yards. You just missed that cut for a freshman.
...404 yards of rushing for the Eagles tonight after going for 413 last week against Western Michigan. First and goal to go. And now Upshaw goes in motion, so Fields will take the direct snap. Tough yards in there, and Fields scores the touchdown.
Georgia Southern.
Jeremiah Cobra, Darian Foreman, Roscoe Beard, Tommy Boynton. Only way you can get that kind of yardage on the ground is somebody is up front blocking and backs are running hard. Tough yards, tough touchdown right there by the freshman Wesley Fields.
First collegiate touchdown for Wesley Fields makes it 47-7. 41-point lead for Georgia Southern in the opening 2 minutes of this fourth quarter. Fields heads to the bench, gets his first college touchdown. Georgia Southern alum Luke Bryan going to take us to break as the Eagles are in command. Four different Georgia Southern Eagles have scored tonight. Matt Breida on touchdown runs of 25 and 87 yards. Ellison on touchdown runs of 1 and 9 yards. Ramsby went in from 7 yards out. And Wesley Fields just took it in from 2 yards out. And the Eagles with a 48-7 lead.
Fields showing you that he's a smart freshman. What I'm going to do is what Breida does and follow the big fellas wherever they go. Just get behind them on that touchdown and put your shoulders down and push into the end zone. Great run, great read, great blocking by Georgia Southern.
Kick taken at the 15-yard line. Vinny Miller on the return. And the Bulldogs head back on offense. We do have a flag down on the field. Well, Brent Thompson, the Bulldogs offensive coordinator, said if they threw the ball 10 times tonight, they'd probably be in trouble. Well, they've thrown it only 3 times tonight, and they are still in trouble.
Three attempts and 2 interceptions in that.
Personal foul, illegal hand to the face. Number 28 of the kicking team. It's a 15-yard penalty will be added to the end of the run. First down.
So the penalty going against Georgia Southern. And a 15-yard mark off in favor of the Bulldogs. Gives the Citadel the ball at the 48.
And if you're Brent Thompson in this offense, you still come out and just trying to build successfully. You're 2-0. There's nothing shameful about losing to this Georgia Southern team, a team that just seems to be not only stepped out of conference, but might just be 2 steps ahead of you in talent. Just take the time that is left and try to have some positivity leaving this stadium.
Hosting Georgia Southern next week, Rod Johnson gets the carry and a flag comes out.
Rod Johnson on the carry. Tackle made for the Eagles by Zach Copeland.
Offside. Defense number 57. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Still first down.
Zach Copeland, number 57, called for the offsides on Georgia Southern. He was the guy that made the tackle. So
that's how he got there so quick.
gave away his secret. He got an early step on everybody. So first and 5 now as the ball across the 50, now at the Georgia Southern 47. Renew on the carry for the Citadel. 2-yard pickup for Tyler Renew, who gets his first carry of the ball game.
Can't say enough about this defense of Georgia Southern. Only one drive that really amounted to anything for, as you can see on the scoreboard, they have been stout. Couple of big runs in the middle, but other than that, even though this is a one-dimensional team, they have shut out the outside run completely for the Citadel.
Second down and 3. Dominique Allen close to the first down. Think he got it. 13th carry of the night for Allen. That'll put him right at 40 yards. So yards have been hard to come by for Dominique Allen. Just making his third. He's a sophomore out of Georgia in the Augusta area. So about an hour and a half up the road from here. making just his third career start.
Correction, first down.
And he did get the first down on that carry, so first and 10, fresh set of downs for the Bulldogs. Ball is fumbled as Allen and Renew collide in the backfield. And apparently the Bulldogs covered it.
Worst thing you can have happen is the misery of starting to make little mental errors right there. Timing off, you change backs in the triple option. Things do get a little different. Guys do hit the hole a little different. You don't want to see that at the end of this game if you're the Citadel. You want to try to end on a positive note.
Trey Griffin, number 94 for Georgia Southern, had the ball fall right at his feet. He's wondering still how he didn't come up with it.
He's going to talk about that all night. Man, I saw it. It was right there.
Is that what you linemen do?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you sit there and commiserate over the fumbles that you didn't pick up and
then
score.
We fantasize about how we would have got picked it up and got the first down.
Third down and 8, ball at the 40. Allen on the keeper. About 4.5 on the play, bringing up a fourth down, which I'm likely the Bulldogs will try to get. Try to convert.
His defense has just been very good on the edges. Nothing, once he gets out of that tackle area, there haven't been any real big run. Yep. Everything has come inside.
Yeah, in fact, the big hitter, the one big play they hit on him was
right up the middle.
Fourth down, and the Bulldogs going for it. 9.5 minutes to play. Allen, keeper, and he didn't get there. So a big defensive stop by Georgia Southern that continues. Caleb Williams, the cornerback. Actually, not Williams, the corner, but Ken Butler, the linebacker, number 18, was there to make that stop. Ball goes over to the Eagles when we get back.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, I love it when you get that beat. Boots on, stomp your feet.
Georgia Southern, 48-7 lead as we're down to our final 9:23 here at Paulson Stadium. And look at the ground attack by the Eagles tonight. A total of 309 yards rushing, 410 total, 159 by Breda, 62 from Wesley Fields, and 60 from Ramsby.
Georgia Southern fans, get used to that. Look, that board right there, those three faces is what's going to take this team to the bowl game this year.
Big hole up the middle, and Chaz Thornton looks like he fumbled the ball at the end of the play, and the Citadels got it. Chaz Thornton with a huge run on the first snap coming out of the break, ran all the way down the field and fumbled the ball apparently at the end of the play.
Another back with speed, Matt. Another back with speed. What great hustle there by number 23.
And that's a touchback for the Citadel. Look at that. That's a super play downfield by the Citadel. Tyus Carter to strip him of the ball before he got into the end zone. Thornton, who is a freshman, was carrying the ball with his left hand, his inside hand rather than his outside hand, hadn't made the switch over. That left it vulnerable.
And what's so good about that play is the effort not to give up. It's 48-7. Most players in that situation would have just given up the touchdown. For him to run that hard to get that, I think we're going to review it here, Matt.
Yeah, well, the crowd believes that it was a touchdown.
The
crowd is thrilled to hear that Willie Fritz is challenging the call. Let's take another look at it. Is he in the end zone? Ball, no, not even close.
Not even close right there. great hustle by Tyus Carter. I've seen many plays in my years where that safety just decides that, hey, what's another score? We're already down. We're not going to win. Why would I run all out to chase somebody down? Tyus Carter coming in. And as you said, Matt, ball in the wrong hand. And sometimes when backs break out, they don't really, and they feel like they're going to outrun you, they forget technique. And the technique right there is to always put the ball towards the sideline. Yep. Never switch. Gives the defender a chance to strip the ball.
And let me correct myself. I said Chaz Thornton, the freshman. He's actually a redshirt sophomore. Broke off the big run, but got stripped at the 2-yard line when it looked like a touchdown was imminent. imminent. And Tyus Carter got on top of that thing.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. It is a touchback. Georgia Southern has charged a timeout and loses their challenge the remainder of the game.
And that technique right there by Tyus Carter is something that the good teams practice. It's a 5-10 minute drill that the secondary coach, he goes over there and he has the one cornerback or one safety hold the ball and the other one actually practice that move.
Well, that was a point of emphasis for Maurice Drayton and his defense. He's the DC for Citadel. Not that you could see it tonight with the result in Georgia Southern's big victory, but one of the things they really worked on in the spring were turnovers. And the defensive side of the ball had to get X number of turnovers during practice or there were consequences. And I'm sure those consequences weren't pleasant.
No, something tells me it was a lot of grunting and sweating along with that.
a lot of reason to want to get the turnover, to avoid extra work in practice. Pitch. Rod Johnson on the carry. He picks up the first down.
First time tonight we've seen something that big on the edge. It's been usually tackle for a loss or 2-3 yards. This team is still showing you heart and fight even in the end.
So ball at the 41-yard line. First down for the Citadel. Tyler Renew up the middle. Patrick Flo, the linebacker, in there for the tackle.
Stop is made by Patrick Flo.
Patrick Flo, the son of longtime and very successful Georgia high school football coach Cecil Flo, led Parkview to 3 straight state championships.
That play has been there all night for the Bulldogs. Evan McPhee was running it earlier for big yardage. And I know they're going to get the stats tomorrow, and it's going to look like the Citadel was dominating on the ground, but not many big plays for them.
Allen goes up top looking for Brandon Eakins down the far sideline. Allen now 0 for 4 passing.
0 for 4, 2 interceptions, and none of it, the whole mechanics of it haven't looked good between the receiver, the quarterback. Yeah. None of it has looked good when they drop back to throw at all.
Well, Wayne, we commented on that as we were watching them in their pregame warmups. I mean, just against air in pregame warmups, they did not look comfortable in the passing game.
Yeah, he was missing the target then, and they had that kind of posture of, I hope it gets there.
Allen runs for the first down as he crosses the 50 and gets down to the Georgia Southern 46.
Hicklin makes a stop for the Eagles. Gain is enough for a
Allen carries a lot of responsibility. He is actually making these reads right here with the ball. It's not, we asked the coach, and how much is just a call play? And he was honest in saying, you know, 20-25% is called. The rest of it is on Allen to make the decision what to do with the ball.
Allen again.
Down
across the 40, down to the 39. About 6 yards on the play for Allen. He's building his numbers up. His rushing total is going to end up looking a lot better here as they add to him in the fourth quarter than they actually were. 18 carries now for Allen. 17 carries now for Allen and 61 yards. Oh, no, I was right. 18 now up to 68. Second down. Renewed.
And you're actually doing what Georgia Southern really wants you to do, which is running the ball, which that's basically all they're capable of doing in this position is running the ball. But right now the clock is Georgia Southern's friend. They're making some hay, making some yards, converting some third downs, but it is taking a long time to get the ball down the field.
One player that we did not see run the ball for Citadel tonight, Isaiah Smith, their backup B-back, who had 32 carries for 165 coming in. There was no report that he was injured. And we had talked to head coach Mike Houston, no report of an injury there. But he has not carried the ball at all tonight. In fact, I don't think he's even been in the ball game at all.
Yeah, and he talked about Isaiah Smith with high regards, and he was the toughest back I had, the best blocker, even the best catchers. It's very surprising he's not been in this game at all.
Don't know if there was a late injury or some other something is going on here, but we have not seen Isaiah Smith tonight. First and 10, Citadel putting together a pretty solid drive here in the fourth quarter against the Georgia Southern backups. Cam Jackson on the pitch and run inside the 20 and down inside the 15 for Cam Jackson.
Whether it's 2 yards or 3 yards, you can just tell this team is built for running. They're not in a hurry. They're not spreading, calling wild plays. They're walking to the line. They're having success, but even in that, they're falling into the hand of what the Eagles want, and that is time running off the clock.
Cam Jackson on that run right there. SoCon all-freshman team a year ago, over 500 yards rushing. First and 10 for the Bulldogs. Short game there for Allen. That puts him right at 70 yards rushing on the night.
Talking to Coach Houston, it was very interesting how he said, really, I have to build my team through recruits.
Yep.
I don't have a program that players are lining up to transfer to. So it's tough sledding, getting people in, because I have to have success through recruitment.
And Cam Jackson with the run and then hurls the billboards over there on the sideline. You know, and a lot of that also has to do with the academic regimen and the military regimen of the Citadel. I mean, it's a program and an institution that's not really conducive to transfers. It's number one, it takes a special kind of person to enter into the program in the first place. So you go into it knowing that's the case. He had great success at Lenoir Rhyne. Took a program that hadn't been to the playoffs in 50 years and got him to the national championship game in his third season. Cam Jackson, they're hoping he's able to do the same here at the Citadel as Cam Jackson steps into the end zone for the Bulldogs' second touchdown of the night.
Cam Jackson in this drive finally finding some success out on the pitch. Really, this whole game, any running success was inside. Right there, Cam Jackson, getting to the edge, getting the pitch, touchdown, Citadel.
First rushing touchdown of the season for Cam Jackson as they'll go for two right here. And the pass is thrown incomplete by Dane Anderson.
Try for two by number six, Dane Anderson called.
48-13, Cam Jackson with the score. But it's been the Eagles tonight. Georgia Southern with 4:11 to play. The Eagles will take their 19th victory out of 24 all-time meetings against the Citadel. Time now to salute our Capital One Impact Performance, and it is Matt Breida.
Matt Breida, the first 2 or 3 carries were 2 or 3 yards. The next 10 carries, up over 100 yards, big runs from great distances. Matt Breida showing you that he's one of the top tailbacks, not just in the Sun Belt, but in the country.
Breida, 13 carries for 159 yards and touchdown runs of 25 and 87 yards. So get this, Breida now for the season as he records his ninth 100-yard career rushing game. Breida now for the season, 41 carries for 405 yards. That is a 9.9 yards per carry average. Better than his 8.68 yards per carry average last year, which was number one in the nation. That's and broke the Georgia Southern single-season record set by Adrian Peterson back in 1998.
Scholarship worthy. And the thing that I like about this backfield is they seem to all just fit the role. It seems that when one gets in, it almost set fire, like, oh, okay, I'm going to get me a big run. And that kind of impact gives Kevin Ellison time to get back in the groove, watch out Sun Belt once again.
Ball will go into the end zone, and that'll be a touchback. Eagles were playing up, anticipating an onside kick. And so Georgia Southern goes back on offense, and let's see if they go a little bit deeper in their quarterback rotation here. Looks like Upshaw is going to go back out there again.
And I know we give all the tailbacks all the credit, but as we said early in this program, this is a big, massive offensive line. Running the ball is in their blood. This is what they want to do. They seem to do it well, and these small, fast running backs really take advantage of it.
There's another one right there. Noah Hickey getting his first carry.
Handoff goes to number 20, Noah Hickey.
He picks up 3 yards, make that a little bit more than that. 4.5 yards on the play for Noah Hickey.
If Chaz Thornton scores with that ball, Matt, we're talking about another 70 yards added on to the rushing total.
Yeah.
Very impressive tonight.
380 yards rushing for the Eagles tonight to the Bulldogs 314. So we're talking a total of 694 yards on the ground between these two teams. Been a while since I had a game like that.
You have to go back to the 80s to even find games where both teams put that much effort and that consistency of running the ball. Especially, in, you know, 2015, there's more throwing going on than,
absolutely.
It, is, than it is running. So
that's a pre-Steve Spurrier type offense, which is what most of the, you know, football in the Southeast was prior to, you know, him kind of changing the paradigm of football in this part of the country. That was Thomas Banks on the carry. So they're rotating a bunch of different running backs in there now, giving a chance for some of these deeper reserves to get some action. Banks again. Banks about 3 yards on the play.
I know we fall in love with the pass, but even if you look at all the national champions over the last 5-8 years, all of them had strong running attacks, and Coach Fritz has definitely established that here, that we can run the ball. We can run the ball well. We get Ellison or Upshaw in a solid passing game, and we're a dangerous team.
Fourth down, and Georgia Southern will punt as we click under 2 minutes to play. Nowicki with the punt again, and Schultz will take from the 24. And Schultz finally put on the ground at the 27-yard line.
And
we have a flag down. I don't think so.
We might have a holding call out here at the 50.
There is a flag on the play.
Jason MacArthur out there talking things over. Georgia Southern will be 2-1 on the season, 2-0 at home. Sun Belt opener coming next Saturday at Idaho. Citadel will drop to 2-1. They'll be back home next week hosting Charleston Southern. Their next SoCon game, not until October 10th when they host Wofford. Wofford was playing at Idaho today.
Matt, I tell you, I don't think I've ever been to the state of Idaho. Have you?
Personal foul, number 24 of the kicking team. The foul occurred during the kick. It'll be a 15-yard penalty added to the end of the run. First down.
Riyad Jones is going to be called for the penalty for Georgia Southern, so they'll tack on 15 yards to the return. Willie Fritz will soon be 11-2 when outrushing opponents. Not him, but his teams. Right at 400 yards on the ground tonight. So let's see. They'll spot the ball at the 43-yard line for what will likely be the final possession of the night.
A long debate about this call.
I want to make sure they get it right.
Correction. The foul was against the receiving team during the kick. So the end of the kick.
Okay, so the penalty is not on Georgia Southern at all. It's on the Citadel. So they marked off the 15 yards wrong.
The Bulldogs can't catch a break in any area tonight.
Well, Mike Hughes is like, come on, man. We're down 35. Elsewhere involving Sunbelt teams this evening, Arkansas State going to pick up their first win of the season. They're blowing out Missouri State 56-0 early in the third quarter. Texas State at home hosting Southern Miss, trailing 28-25. That's early in the third quarter. South Alabama down 17-3 in the second quarter at San Diego State. New Mexico State with a 13-9 lead over UTEP. That's in the second quarter. That's a big rivalry game for the Aggies. Earlier today, Georgia State was beaten badly at number 12 Oregon, 61-28. Number 24 Wisconsin beat Troy 28-3.
The foul that occurred was holding, not a personal foul. It is a 10-yard penalty. Against the receiving team. First down.
There you go. They got it straight. And Idaho did beat Wofford, so the Vandals pick up their first win of the season. That was a 41-38 victory for Idaho. So first and 10 for the Bulldogs. They get it all straightened out and the ball at the 14-yard line. First completion of the night for Allen goes to Vinny Miller up to the 41-yard line.
I think at this point in the game, that might be considered a trick play by the Bulldogs. Not a lot of success, not even a lot of attempts up until that point by Dominique Allen. Nice to see him get off of that offer as far as completions go.
I know he's happy about it. So first and 10, ball at the 41-yard line. Going to go to the air again and looking for Glover, and he one hops it to Glover that time.
Pass intended for Alex Glover is incomplete.
As I stated earlier, just the mechanics of throwing the ball as an offense, it doesn't, even on that pass right there to Alex Glover, it didn't even really seem like he was throwing him the ball as much as it was getting the ball out of his hand. Something that, as the season goes, they're going to have to be able to complete some passes.
Allen, heavy rush, gets rid of it. That's a nice catch at the 45-yard line. Jorian Jordan with that grab. How about this? Games involving Southern Conference teams tonight. Furman leads Central Florida 16-15 with 3.5 minutes to play in the game.
Furman over Central Florida.
Yeah, the Paladins with a one-point lead late, and Furman has the ball. That's on ESPN3. Vinny Miller with the incompletion. Mercer, a 22-21 lead at Tennessee Tech in the fourth quarter. Western Carolina losing at Tennessee 48-3. That's in the third quarter. Chattanooga beats Samford in conference play 31-21. Let's see, VMI, a loser to Richmond, 42-10.
Interesting drive here by the Citadel. They've thrown more passes in this short period than they've thrown the whole game on the last
basically last drive of the game.
Oh, man, what a lick. Dominique Allen got his teeth rattled on that hit right there, but he just did get rid of the pitch.
Big hit by 18, Ken Butler. Backups in the game for Georgia Southern, but the pads are still popping. Clean, legal, big hit. It seems that in modern-day football, all big hits seem to be a penalty. Right there is a nice, clean, in-the-chest hit by Ken Butler.
So Citadel calls a timeout. Bulldogs want to get another score in before this game's over. And here's what's coming up for the Bulldogs. Again, they will be at home against Charleston Southern next Saturday on ESPN3, followed by Wofford on October 10th. That's their next conference game. And the rest of them after that, outside of a season finale at South Carolina, will be conference action in the SoCon. So third down and three coming up for the Bulldogs. Ball at the 38-yard line inside our final minute.
Matt, are you surprised? Bulldog,
well, no, I'm not surprised because I go back to what you were saying earlier. I mean, once the ball game's out of hand, you start working on other things. You're working on your late game drill right here.
That is true. That
you know, and I know the crowd's not happy that they called a timeout, but they're working on a late game drill.
Situational football.
Exactly. In situations where late in the game it's going to be a close game, what are we going to do?
If the game was close, how could we come back if we were down by two?
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Had this kind of time in the game.
Yeah, you see, so that's what they're doing right here. They're preparing for a future situation where it's late in the game and they got to score. Allen going to take a quarterback sack, and it's Butler in there again. 48-13, Georgia Southern. Wayne, your thoughts on this pretty dominating and thorough performance by the Eagles tonight?
Very impressed with how this defense against this running team stood on the edges, soft in the middle. But when you're talking about running the ball, it doesn't get any better than what Georgia Southern did today. And you were just running in backs, and everybody is 60, 70 yards plus from any distance right here. Whether it's Fields, whether it's Breida, as we know, we came in here to see this. Even Kevin Ellison back in for the first time in two games, making plays with his feet. This is just going to be something to be reckoned with in the Sun Belt. This kind of, with four backs, you don't have to worry about people being banged up. You don't have to worry about depth. It's something that you can just keep running with confidence that we have that kind of run game to actually have a plan to stop this run game.
And the ball may have been recovered by Georgia Southern, and it is, and that's going to do it. Patrick Flo comes up with the fumble recovery at the 41-yard line, and now all the Eagles have to do is kill the clock and finish this one off. Next big challenge for Georgia Southern, that long road trip to Idaho, a team that picked up their first win today. They beat a SoCon team 41-38. Wofford.
And when you look at their schedule, I know a lot of people might be like, well, they haven't had a conference game yet. The one thing you do know about conference games, you're going to be up to play them. You don't have to worry about that late game where you're not paying attention. Seven of your next nine games are in conference. Doesn't take a big speech to get you up for conference games.
Final second's going to click off here. Georgia Southern now 2-1 on the season with a 48-13 victory over the Citadel. 384 yards rushing for Georgia Southern, 485 total. Matt Breida, 13 carries for 159, scored on touchdown runs of 25 and 87. And in his first game this season, Kevin Ellison, in his return, throws for 80, runs for 18, and scores a couple of touchdowns. And now for Wayne Gandy and the entire ESPN team, I'm Matt Stewart. So long from Statesboro, Georgia, where the Eagles fly to a 48-13 victory over the Bulldogs.